trust my lens at your feet?
Mm-hmm.
It's on the middle board and it's near the... Don't throw those up here, okay? Please.
Wait.
How does he control the change in the
What, on the inside? Well, it seems to me what he did is that he didn't worry about that angle for a long time. He just came up and made the angle of his brick stayed at about the same plane until about, well, late yesterday afternoon. And then he started really tilting them. And now he's really tilting them. Pardon? Mm-hmm. Sure.
But he's not going to be able to tell us what
it's
like.
No, that's too big of a deal. So he wants to know when he comes up what his angle is, when he decides his angle and how.
The stick sits like this. He goes by this edge.
He fixes this, the end by means of a stone to guard the inclination.
When he gets that course done, when that stick gets moved to this side, you look at the stick. Now imagine this is the stick.
Well, the stick's right here.
No, I know, but I can't touch it.
Okay.
Here's the stick. There's a corner here, and there's a corner here against the other stick, the longer stick. Watch the angle here and the inside corner. That's what he measures by. That distance there, it appears. That's what I've seen since he began this dome.
You want the mud from out here?
No, we're going to be bringing it out from outside. Is there a place I can hand it to you?
Isaiah Abdel Latif.
I think over here would be better.
Wait, no.
Hey, somebody's climbing up,
that's
Bill.
What I thought earlier.
Oh, yeah, it's beautiful.
not the mud.
You have to rinse that out.
Cello.
Mud. It's mud, it's coming.
Water.
One a day, never mind. More mud.
He used to work for some.
It's coming.
Building people, most of them were Japanese. A feudal hierarchy.
For a maestro, a ma'alim kbir.
Grab you, but. No, I can still get mud.
You got mud. Okay.
Fantastic.
More mud.
Compressing. Less than perfect radius.
The guy beneath that.
Always less. So it'll stay. So you're coming up. Rather than coming up on a perfect radius, you're coming up under the radius. So when you get up to the top, rather than it being vertical, it's V-shaped.
I see. But this angle, how does he determine which each course, how much to bring in?
You want to break your mind. Move this down.
He learned by having his knuckles wrapped.
It is working as it must be. As architects or as builders,
that
is
done on the other dome.
Calculation structural engineer.
No, we have to learn to do this ourselves.
You already learned.
Go for me, if you will, Tom, what you were just talking about.
Due to that, to your
more tubes, thin ones.
Adobe.
In other words, the angle.
Not into the logo yet.
This angle to the stick. Always the same. Down there,
from
all the
down
way.
Only if you
I've got kind of propped in here.
Follow that.
Just kind of shift a little bit. Rest your hip on it.
Vertical after one layer.
You have little narrow slices that wouldn't stick very well.
Right.
So by leaving it more slant, you get more sticks. You come all together until it finally touches, and then you fill in with a...
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
I guess it just comes by feel of doing it.
That's what it is all about.
I think that the answers really lie in the dome and what he's doing rather than in the numbers.
Well, I got the numbers, but it's somehow he's got this radius worked out. I got with the stick, but how does
it
keep coming in?
Less than perfect.
Less than perfect.
Somebody.
See you.
shovies.
Okay.
Okay.
It's all related to the stick that we just took out. It's that angle.
Yeah, but what's it? The steepest one
to knock down the pyramids.
We have
on you the mud. there?
No, it's
fine.
See, Muhammad didn't do it that way. Muhammad would lay three or four and then put his stick on. Thank you. He left for Boston this morning. And these guys are going to finish off this, and then their plan is to go shopping in Santa Fe on Friday, I guess. Six or seven people on the dome handing him stuff and handing him materials. Had their foot, some of them had their foot in the holes there for the windows. And other ones were just kind of sitting down on it, getting the mud and brick. And he kept going around and around until they. Is he making that side a little thinner this time?
He's adjusting to the, some bricks are a little wider.
Uh-huh. I see it.
Yeah, he did that yesterday also.
Some here, and he cuts a little here, whereas they wedge in.
Uh-huh.
It's not much. And the more he gets toward the center, the more he chips in. Like what he's doing now, he chip here and here, and come with a little angle here.
Uh-huh.
He gets toward the center. It's not like he's doing now.
Uh-huh. So now, when he's coming up the wall, he's just chipping one corner, basically. But when he gets further towards the center, he chips both corners.
Right, he'll chip both corners. And he may even chip the back to make it small, depending on the, like he's using his eye,
uh-huh.
his eye to keep the course straight.
Uh-huh.
Watch when he gets to the center. Well, okay, he's gonna have to come up the other side. When he gets to the center, you'll see.
Understands what you said then.
usable water.
For washing, for that is another thing.
Right, it might be so hard for washing that it won't be a pleasant thing to use.
Another thing of bringing people together, because you don't, you know, when I lived in Mecca, I drew all of my water from the well. Well, all of the water in the house was desalinated water, which I don't prefer to drink. It lacks certain things. So you get in the habit of going to the well to get the water, which I did every day, for the drinking water. And we had three adults, two adults and three children. So, I mean, that's, and it's not hard.
Oh, no.
And plus, it brings people together, and it's that kind of thing. So, all of those things have to be thought about, and how, you know, I mean, just...
Right, those are the kind of things.
Yeah, right,
in
the toilets, so that no waste is lost in that.
And gardens.
And, you know, well, then that... Well, now, Adnan has been doing fountains for sure, and how to recycle them, and rather than have them shooting up in the air and evaporating, having rip ponds, which are more practical to this climate than a geyser, because, I mean, you just don't evaporate very much water. You know what I mean? Rip ponds with shading set in certain parts of the village, you know, are nice, right? So, and also for the big Jami Masjid, besides the taps and things like that, you know, which is only usable X amount of time of the year, but that X amount of time of the year is too much. So all those things will have to be, and I don't know that much about it. So
that's what I've been doing with my juggling act. That's what I really enjoy doing.
Right. So I think the way that I could envision it being done is when we receive the master plans, is we go over them, or I let you see a copy of them.
And then have a brainstorming session.
Yeah, then you think about it, you know, like for a time, you know, like where you see how, you know, possibilities, you know, that you might think. Now, there are a lot of other people, especially there are a lot of Muslim scientists in America who are dealing with it, all those kind of things, but I'm afraid, you see, they come from the East and they take more of a Western approach to things. But they would want to, we'd want to include them. And so I would imagine that at some point we'd all sit down and kind of, you know, kind of run through the possible options. And that'll be, I think, a good...
It'd be a good start. And from that point, you could actually see
who's
where it would
do
be of value.
Right, you know, yeah. Yeah. Do well. So
I always want the opening into a village of this scale.
Oh, yeah, no, because the technical solutions may work 20 years from now, but then they may not.
But they aren't
biological ones.
Yeah.
Will
have feedback.
Yeah. Well, and they keep working.
Right.
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 You know, I'm fond of mitten hoops and things like that.
Right.
You know, rather than compacting.
Well, I'm also fond of grape arbors and matas that are functioning as a...
Exactly. All those kind of things.
Yeah.
And we have this other man, Mohammed Khan, who is our agricultural advisor.
Right.
And he is Pathan. And he's already come out here, and I already have his agriculture report. Plus, I have the state extension service one. And it would be useful to develop, I think, also an alternative one. And then let's see, you know, like how those, you know, given this amount of fields, given this amount of water, given this amount of irrigation, right, what is...
And this amount of people.
Yeah, well, I mean, but the people is also projections of people, right? So you have to begin from someplace.
Right.
And you may have to begin... Well, you may not have to begin as you think, like with, you know, French intensive or that kind of intensive thing, but you may have to just even contract out. See, like now we're grazing cattle on our
right.
field, and we're getting rent from the cattle.
Right.
Right? Okay, that's all right. You
yeah.
All
you'd,
right.
you'd want to cut into that slowly, but if you wanted to have melons every 10 feet and strips of clover 8 feet wide
right.
and little greenhouses so tractors could do it
right.
and the melons could be planted.
Right, so that maybe, right, so that maybe like two or three people could start, whereas that we would see downstream 5 or 6 years later that those things would all start turning into private.
this area, we've been in this area for about 15 years, and about 7 years ago, I think a considerable number of the people that we've been working with became Muslim, slowly, some and quickly others. And then at that point, we were still at Lama Foundation, which I helped to found. And we began expanding. And we reached a point where it was really a question of whether they could continue functioning as they were functioning, which was as a place which made available to people the way this place is making available to people building techniques and so forth, and spiritual techniques and practices, or whether we could live there. And as Muslims, as we wanted to live in our own developing our life around that, and it was mutually exclusive. Basically, the people there were very threatened by us, or felt threatened by us, because we were expanding more rapidly than they were at that point. So we kind of left with the understanding among many of us that we would try and continue that work here in New Mexico, but in a way that was totally Islamic rather than dealing with other things at the same time. And at that point, I went to Mecca to study, where I've been living the last three years. And when I was living there, I met another person from that country, Saudi Arabia, who is an engineer and had had his training in America. And he was very keen. He had many of the same ideas that we had. And he felt that he had learned a lot from his stay in America. And he wanted to repay America by giving them the best of what he felt was the best from his world, whereas he felt it the kind of technical education and experience that he had received here was the best from this world. And so we began. This all happened in Mecca, in the Masjid al-Haram, which is where the Kaaba is in Mecca. And so he and I began to develop these ideas, and our ideas, we come from two very divergent viewpoints. I mean, at first it was difficult for him to understand why we wanted to use mud instead of pre-stressed concrete and steel and, you know, make 40-foot spans and like this. But all of those things have slowly been worked out. He met Hassan Fathi and got acquainted with his ideas and began to understand that a lot of technological process or so-called progress is really a backward motion of history rather than a forward motion of history. So, and on the other hand, many of his ideas have influenced us insofar as, you know, thinking about planning and planning very carefully and trying to understand the growth of things and so forth. So it's very complementary kind of thing. So last year, which was 1979, I came back to the States and also to England for the express purpose of looking for land for a community of this sort. And I spent about a month and a half or so, a month and a half in England, in the south of England, looking for land, and a lot of information on the southeastern part of the United States, and of course on the southwestern part of the United States, which is what I favor myself because the climate and the ecology and the landscape and the latitude and everything is, Muslims have always dwelt in landscapes like this, and it's very easy to, one feels at home here, and the buildings feel at home here, and the way of life all fits together. So I spent about a month and a half again here, driving every day and meeting realtors and so on and so forth, until we found this piece of land. basic surrenders that are available for human beings. You can either surrender to yourself, and then to yourself as an imperfect person, you take your chances with that. Or you can surrender to another human being. And I think this was the phase of in the spiritual evolution that took place in the 60s and the 70s in America, which gave rise to gurus and teachers and masters and sheikhs and all of these kind of things, which was surrender to people. And the Beatles surrendering to Guru Maharishi, and this guru coming this week and this lama coming the next week, which was part of the climate at that time. Or you can finally understand that all beings emanate from the Creator, and you can find a way to surrender to the Creator of all, everything we see and everything we don't see. And that's Islam.
What do you need?
And most people think of Islam as a religion which came from the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in reality, it's a religion which has existed from the time of Adam, which is
my boy.
That
I
the
will
only
get them for you.
Real possibility for human life consists in surrender to the Creator. And that's very finely detailed and everything else. The whole message has evolved from the time of Adam forward, and all of the prophets all attested to that message. So that's basically who we are those people who have surrendered. And this place is the house of the surrendered people, or the Muslims, which is also Muhsalam, are those who have peace, or those who are surrendered. So that gives you the meaning of what Darul
mm-hmm.
Islam means,
mm-hmm.
the house of surrender, which yields or leads to peace. Unfortunately, also in America, in most of the West.
Go ahead.
So the other part of the problem is that basically the people in North America, or in the industrialized nations, or the Western nations, have a very poor understanding of what Islam is. And one of the ideas of the man who I originally started working with, this engineer, his name is Mr. Sahil Kabbani, was that we would like to show people what Islam is really like by creating something in America which was like a model of that, you know, where people could not only live in it and educate their children in it, but other people could learn about it. And after all, I mean, these are the people who invented zero, who invented algebra, who have named almost three quarters of the stars in the sky. And all of this is pretty well forgotten. And we wanted to bring that forward. And one of the ways that we wanted to do that was to gather together the best minds that we could find in the Islamic world to begin planning.